Welcome to Cinderella Has Cellulite, a show about love, romance, and how to make it all last. Relationship expert Donna Arp Weitzman draws on her years of experience in and out of the dating game to unwrap the mysteries behind the all-too-familiar fairy tale. Tune in to find out the secrets behind first dates, second marriages, and everything in between. From his friends and her friends to X's and O's, this is Cinderella Has Cellulite. And now, your host, Donna Arp Weitzman.
Hey, Zach.
Hey, Donna.
Where were you Saturday morning about 3 o'clock?
Oh, gosh. You know, I was probably sleeping, if I had to be honest.
You did not wake up and see Harry and Meghan?
6 a.m. on a Saturday is a lot to ask of a young man, Donna.
I was in Las Vegas, and out there it was 4 a.m. in the morning.
And you were up?
No.
So you didn't watch it either.
You know why? Because I knew cable news would show it over and over and over.
That's the wonder of social media. We'll get the highlights.
Yeah. I got up at 7 o'clock, got my coffee, and sat down and watched those two lovebirds.
What were you doing out in Las Vegas?
I just went out there to actually do some shopping and go to dinner with my husband.
Sure. Shopping and dinner. That's what you do in Vegas.
Of
that's
course.
A good time.
But I stayed away from the tables.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
It's tough.
You know, my son asked me, Mom, did you win any money? I said, I didn't even sit at the table this time.
Yeah?
I'm so discouraged with it.
Really?
Yeah.
That's how I am with gambling. I just assume I'll lose.
That's what I assume.
Better just not.
And what they say about that? Ever heard assume the sale is made? Have you ever heard this?
No.
All right. For those of you out there who like to influence people, win friends, be a good salesman, there's a mental thing in your head that you have to assume that the sale is made, or you have to assume you're going to win. It's the positive thinking kind of thing.
A confidence thing.
Uh-huh. But I don't have it when I go to the tables.
No, not at all.
It leaves me.
Why would they do it if there wasn't potential for the casino to win, right? Like, why would they offer that service? At the end of the day, it seems like a loss. I just shouldn't do it. But what did you think of the royal wedding,
Well,
Donna?
Only in the United States, only in the United States, would they be betting in Las Vegas on the wedding.
They were betting on
the
wedding?
They were betting on what she was going to wear, what designer it was.
Oh, gosh.
Was it American? Was it, British? Was it? But in, I think it was Givenchy. I think it was French.
Yeah?
Yeah. So, Meghan has a mind of her own. She doesn't have to go along to get along.
She has to inject a little bit of that independence into the royal family. I think it's important in any American, and I appreciate that she's bringing that to the table.
I do too, and I'm glad that Harry chose an American. Way to go, Harry!
Way to go, Harry. You know, something I did see that I thought was really cool, that I thought was maybe underscored a little bit, and that's okay. That's kind of the point. Meghan's mother, Doria Ragland, showed up. She wore a pale green dress, and she sat by herself, single mom. Didn't cause a scene.
Just showed up to
her daughter's wedding, played it cool. I was like, way to go, Doria.
Loved it. You know, Meghan must get part of that independent strength from her mother and her strength.
Yeah. She'd have to, right?
Yeah. I just wonder what it's going to be like when Harry comes to United States all the time to visit the family. That's going to be so fun. I hope he has to stop in Dallas.
You know, I'm not sure. I heard there was a little bit of issues with Meghan's family. I heard they were a little on the fence, but I guess that's about as red-blooded American as you get, right?
Well, Harry grew up a royal, and he's the heir. He's the spare to the heir, so I'm sure he's had plenty of ups and downs.
And I think in a weird way, he probably appreciates the crazy family a little bit.
That's what I'm thinking.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I love the song when they pick Stand By Me.
Benny King.
Yeah, see, I think that had a real ulterior motive, a real intrinsic, they're going to stand by each other.
It's a good tune.
Yeah. So anyway, that was the excitement in Vegas. I guess it was the excitement around the world.
It seems like it. Everybody was talking about it. Every news site I looked at, everybody, royal wedding pictures and the gift bags they gave away and what they were wearing and who did what and whether or not the pastor gave a good speech. I don't know.
And putting
$10
down on a British designer versus an American designer.
That's
right. But talking about royal weddings, of course there was the famous royal wedding in the 1980s.
Yeah.
And Prince Charles and Princess Diana.
Oh, yes.
And today we thought it would be really fun to bring on a local author who's actually well-known around the world, who's been to parties around the world and probably covered the Prince Charles, Princess Diana wedding. We have Nancy Smith here. Nancy Smith, wave to the camera. Hello, all the audience out there, the listeners.
Hello, Donna. Thank you for having me today.
Oh, we're delighted. Nancy Smith, if you've not read her books, just go to Amazon right now. check it out. I think you've got several books, don't you, Nancy?
Here's, I have two recent ones.
But you've got a bunch through the years.
Oh, I've had eight.
Eight books. And let me tell you a little bit about Nancy before we get started. I'm going to tell you about her books. Nancy Smith was a society writer. I guess that's what they call it, social writer? Mm-hmm. For the Dallas Morning News. Well, you were at Times Herald to start with, right?
No, I was at the Morning News.
Sorry, Times Herald. I know you're not out there anymore. But I know the Dallas Morning News is, and that's probably because Nancy was your society writer. But how many years did you write about society?
I wrote all the way from 1977 to 1991.
Oh, my gosh. Did you ever meet Liz Smith?
Yes, I did one time.
The Texan lived up in New York?
Yeah, she was from Texas.
Yeah.
And I think Susie Knickerbocker, I think, was originally from Texas, too.
Oh, my gosh. What is it about these Texas grand dames who write about society and become a part of society? Did you cover the Prince Charles, Princess Diana wedding?
No, but I covered every party that was in Dallas during that weekend. I had to get up very early. In fact, I had to get up at 3 o'clock in the morning and be at a party.
Oh my gosh,
in the middle
of
Holland Park, and everybody had to dress formally as though they were going to the wedding.
That's the earliest you probably ever put on a formal dress, right?
Right. There was no sleep for me or anybody else that night.
Nancy, how many parties have you covered?
Well, one time the Dallas Times Herald put out a billboard and it said I had covered 3,000.
3,000?
But that was many years ago.
Yeah.
So I probably covered at least 3,000-4,000 after that.
Oh,
so
you
probably, Zach, can you imagine? She's probably been to somewhere between 5,000 and 10,000 society parties.
That's
crazy.
Wild.
That's
yeah.
crazy.
It's hard to get those numbers.
How in the world do you dress for that? I mean, do you ever wear the same thing?
Well, I had a whole closet that was just ball gowns.
Wow.
Wow.
Yes.
Wow. If we ever want an 80s party, can we come over to your closet?
Oh, definitely. Yes. I still have all those 80s ball gowns still hanging there.
Who was your favorite designer?
Well, I had Christian LaCroix was a fun one. I had Oscar de la Renta.
Oh.
You know, I had a lot of really wonderful designer gowns back then.
Ooh, how wonderful. Well, let's talk about your books, because now you really spend a lot of time writing, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, you still go to lots of parties, because I see you at parties, and I know you're at a lot of
and
parties.
Donna, you give a lot of parties yourself. I know that.
I love to give parties.
Bigger
but
parties.
Let's talk about, I guess we're going to start off with the kind of, not the brand new one, but the one you wrote, what, 2 years ago, maybe?
Uh-huh.
And it's called Churchill on the Riviera. Matt, I hope we're getting a good picture of this. Can we see it?
Yeah, I think it's there.
Churchill on the Riviera. And tell us why you talk about, oh, and there's a beautiful picture of Nancy on the back. Wow. Is that Coco Chanel?
That's Wendy Reeves.
Wendy Reeves, yes. A New York model who dated Cary Grant. And Wendy Reeves was a Texan? No.
Yeah, she was from East Texas.
Boy, the East Texas girls are so pretty. But anyway, Churchill on the Riviera, and tell us why it's named Winston Churchill or Churchill on the Riviera.
Well, Winston Churchill loved to go to the Riviera. Whichever host or hostess would invite him, he would show up because you just could not keep him away from the Riviera. He didn't like all the cold climate of England.
Okay.
And so at every possible opportunity, he would go straight to this villa, that villa. And so when Coco Chanel built the Villa La Palza in 1929. It was built by her and Churchill's best friend, the Duke of Westminster.
Oh, wow. Now, wait a minute. When you say it was built by them, were they partners? Were they lovers?
Lovers.
Oh, they were lovers.
Yes.
Okay, I don't know this. A lot of history here with Coco Chanel. Go ahead, Nancy.
Yes, so they had been together for about 3 years, and Coco decided that they should have a wonderful little domestic place for them to go where they could
away from Paris, away from London,
right? Mm-hmm. Where they could be over the beautiful Mediterranean. So she talked him into helping her build the Villa La Palza, which is recreated at the Dallas Museum of Art.
Oh,
with all and to which Wendy Reeves donated 43 Impressionist paintings by Renoir, Van Gogh, Monet, and Sicily, on and on and on.
Wow.
Well, walk us through that history. So Coco Chanel was lovers with the Duke of Westminster.
Westminster.
And they built this this chateau, I suppose, or something on the Riviera in France.
Uh-huh. It was a villa.
And then what happened to them? And why did they get rid of the chateau or the villa?
Well, the villa is still there. And in fact, it's been bought by Chanel. So if you wear Chanel number five, okay. Yes, the okay. Chanel company bought it in 2015.
Oh, wow.
So it's being made into a very exclusive, beautiful resort. Remember how the greenhouse was in Dallas?
Yes.
Well, that's what they're doing with the Villa La Paza in just to the east of Monaco.
So it's going to be the fanciest fat farm, Zach, probably in the United States. I mean, in the world, not even the United States. Probably the fanciest fat farm in the world because Coco Chanel had no fat. I mean, she must have had like zero fat.
Right. Oh, I think absolutely. Because all the clothes, I think she put them around herself first, make sure that they look good. And then they look good on all the models. And now everybody wishes that they looked equally good in a Chanel. Mm.
Zach, let me ask you, do millennials know anything about this history?
Not a lot.
Not a lot.
At least me. I mean, I'm a millennial man. Maybe it makes a difference if we had a millennial woman, but as far as I know, no.
Women know about Coco Chanel.
Right.
Because they see the Chanel stores everywhere.
Sure. Oh, even I'm familiar with the name. I don't know enough about the woman, but I know Coco Chanel. Sure.
Okay. So she has this love affair with the Duke, and then what happens to the love affair?
Well, just about the next year, he decided, Winston Churchill said, you cannot marry Coco Chanel. She was an orphan. She was poor, born in the poorhouse.
No royal blood in that.
Oh,
in those veins.
I mean, absolutely. Just almost a homeless person. And so he talked her, the Duke of Westminster into marrying an aristocrat from England.
Of course he did.
And so they got married. And immediately didn't like each other anymore. And he went right back to Coco Chanel.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, wow. And so how long did they stay together?
Well, for about the next 5 or 6 years. But he died in 1953.
Oh.
And after he died, that's what made Coco Chanel think it's time to sell the villa.
Oh.
So then she sold the villa to Emery and Wendy Reeves.
And talk to us about Emery and Wendy Reeves. I know if you're from Dallas, you know the name because they lived here in Dallas.
Right.
Fabulous.
Well, they never lived here.
Oh, really?
Really.
Oh.
Because she lived in Marshall. And she had
Texas, yes.
She had never set foot in Dallas before she gave the entire collection of Impressionist paintings to the Dallas Museum of Art.
Are you kidding?
I'm serious. That's exactly the way it happened.
So she lived in Marshall, Texas, and she went to New York, I suppose, as a model.
Uh-huh.
And how did she meet Mr. Reeves?
Well, in New York.
In New York.
Uh-huh.
But was he from Dallas?
Oh, no. He was from Hungary.
From Hungary.
Originally.
Okay.
And he was the person that put together the syndicate for which Winston Churchill wrote.
Oh, well, now let me ask then, why did she choose the Dallas Museum of Art to give her paintings?
Because Harry Parker, used to be the Dallas Museum of Art director, he took the associates over there it's about 3 or 4 years before Emery died.
He went to France to see
the
villa.
They went there, and they had arranged to go to the Villa La Paza.
Mm-hmm.
And when they got there, Emery was too sick to let them come into the villa. And Wendy had to call Harry Parker and say, I'm so sorry. All of you wonderful people cannot come to the villa today, but I hope in the future we'll have a long-standing relationship.
Oh, boy, do they ever.
So Harry Parker made such a great impression. He was so gracious toward Wendy. She never forgot that. So when it came time to deciding where to take all of those wonderful paintings, she Harry called her and said, I understand Emery has passed away. We would love to have those paintings at the Dallas Museum of Art. So she said, please come, let's talk about it.
And that's a permanent collection at the DMA
here
in Dallas.
Yes, it sure is, yes.
So you can see them anytime. Mm-hmm. Did she have children?
She had one son, and he was born in Hawaii she was married when she was 17 years old and moved to Hawaii. And her husband was in the military.
Okay. So she became a model after she became a mother.
Right.
Wow. And so what made you want to write Churchill and the Riviera? What was your motivating factor?
Well, I was so fortunate that I got to know Wendy so well that she invited me to be her guest twice at the Villa La Paza in close to Monaco. So when I went over there, I had no idea what was going to happen to me. And as it turns out, she wouldn't let anybody actually stay at the Villa La Palza. She put me at the Hermitage Hotel, which is the most beautiful hotel in all of Monaco, in a room overlooking the yacht basin with a palace of, well, Princess Grace by that point had already died, but Prince Rainier's palace was right across the yacht basin.
Wow. So, Zach, when, you know, the big day comes for you, is Paris and, you know, the Riviera on your...
You know, I've been toying with the idea of travel because, you know, while throwing a big wedding is a lot of fun, I think... I don't know.
Sometimes
going out.
a small wedding and a big
honeymoon
is
so bad.
Yeah,
sure.
Lots to think about.
You start to
there.
Mix the two, you can get into like eloping territory. Certainly some possibilities. Yeah, and I haven't spent a lot of time overseas, but I've never made it over to Paris, and I gotta check it out at some point.
Yeah,
right? How can you not?
And the Riviera,
of course.
Of course,
Churchill was a fan.
It's really a hop and a skip to the Riviera.
Yeah,
you can take a train, you can drive. I mean, not hitchhike, probably.
There's ways to make it over there.
Mm-hmm,
so I'm curious, Nancy, I wanted to ask, how did you go from being a society writer for Dallas Morning News to writing what is essentially like history, getting into like really, really kind of older stories? How'd that happen?
Well, I went to Europe 12 times.
12 times. Okay.
And every opportunity, somebody would say, oh, well, one time we were on Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous, where we went there to Saint-Tropez, and then we ended up back in Paris. Anyway, I went, when I was 14 years old, my mother sent me to Europe, to Switzerland, to study European culture. So I came back, just everything that ever crossed my path about France, I wanted to know.
Yeah.
So then finally... I noticed that nobody ever talked about the 19th century. They talked about Napoleon, which was the very early 19th century, and they talked about the Belle Epoque, which was the Moulin Rouge,
sure,
and all that. And then they went right into World War I, World War II, never even talked about what happened between about 1850 and 1870. And right there in the middle was the Franco-Prussian War, which was one of the most strategically terrible wars that ever happened, because it led to communism, it led to the total destabilization of Europe.
Yeah.
And it was a huge war, and nobody in America knows very much about it.
Yeah.
And yet Karl Marx was right across the pond in England writing about how wonderful the Commune of Paris was as an example of what a country like Russia could do with communism to make it a proletariat for all the people. So we have been totally directly influenced by what happened during that period of history, but they don't even teach it at SMU. I graduated from SMU. They don't teach it there.
Right.
They don't teach it in high schools at all. So I got really deeply into studying that period, and I started giving speeches to ladies' groups. They didn't know anything about it either.
Mm.
So it was like discovering an unknown period of French history, which made Paris the way it is right now. The reason the people like Donna love to go to Paris is it's so beautiful, and it was revitalized under Napoleon III, the emperor, and his empress was Empress Eugenie. And she was absolutely the prototype of Scarlett O'Hara.
So that goes into, that is so interesting, that goes into why you wrote your most recent book, which is the original Scarlett O'Hara, Similarity to the French Empress Eugenie, who impacted the Civil War, Mexico, the Lincoln White House, and the Gilded Age. This is magnificent. Tell us about Princess Eugenie, or she was an empress, and what... Tell us all about it. I'm excited.
There actually is a Princess Eugenie, and she's the granddaughter
of
Queen Elizabeth.
Yes. And she's the one with the funky hat.
That's right. Uh-huh. And Beatrice, remember?
Yes.
Very funky hats. Uh-huh. And her godmother was Victoria Eugenie,
okay,
who was the a goddaughter of Empress Eugenie. So
wow.
The name goes straight back to Empress Eugenie.
Wow.
And that's how she got her name.
Where was Princess Eugenie Eugenie from, or the Empress? Was she French?
No, she was from Spain.
She
was born in Granada.
Okay.
And there's such a division between Spain and France. The language, of course, is different. Mm-hmm. The pyramids are, the Pyrenees mm-hmm. are in the middle. And so a lot of the people in France never understood what her background was. Mm-hmm. It turned out that she had a man that she loved ever since she was 18 years old. And she and her sister both vied for the same man.
Uh-oh.
He was the most handsome man in Madrid in the 1830s all the way up to the 1860s.
Wow.
And finally, the sister died, and Eugenie thought, oh, now it's my chance. I'm going to be... I'm going to bring him to Paris, and we're going to be companions. I'm going to ease Napoleon III, my husband, out of the way, and we're going to control both France and Spain.
Wow, she was an aggressive...
Mm-hmm. A firecracker.
Yeah.
She was. So she tried to... She was like a little Napoleon who tried... I mean, you know, I hope Megan doesn't get ideas about trying to take over all of Europe.
I know.
But it would be like if Megan married Harry and then suddenly they decided, oh, well, there's Germany out there. Let's take over Germany.
So
let's
she has take a lover from Germany.
Yes, absolutely. So that's what Eugenie tried to do in conjunction with this man in Spain that she had loved all of her life. And the relationship went all the way up into their 80s.
Wow.
She still loved him when she was in her 80s, all the way until he died in 1909.
Wow.
And so it's absolutely one of the great love stories of all history that nobody knows anything about.
Is it in here?
Yes.
I want to read this book. Well, now, why Scarlett O'Hara? Why did she, why was she modeled after Princess Eugenie?
Well, Margaret Mitchell.
Or Empress, I should say.
As it turned out, Margaret Mitchell loved a man. Their first love was a man that she knew in college.
Okay.
She was about to go to Smith.
Okay.
And they fell in love the summer right before she went to Smith, and he was shipped off to World War I.
Okay.
So they communicated constantly. We're going to marry after he got back, and he was killed.
Oh.
And that was the biggest heartbreak of her life. So even though she had never been to France in her life, mm-hmm. she gave part of the royalties to France to restore a village after World War II.
Wow.
So that was one of the last things that she ever did, because she died in 1949 in Atlanta. And she had never been to Paris, never been to France, but yet she was sending money to restore a French village, obviously in the memory of this man that she loved so much.
Wow. Okay, so you think she modeled, and you talk about that in the book, she modeled her character, Scarlett O'Hara, after Princess or Empress Eugenie.
Yes, because mm-hmm. the basis of Gone with the Wind is an unrequited
That's
love.
That's right.
Scarlett just chased
she
after Ashley.
She
was not going to do anything until she could get
mm-hmm.
Ashley.
Mm-hmm.
So the same thing with Eugenie. She chased after this man named Pepe, the Duke of Sesto, all the way until she was 80 years old. Even then, she had built a villa on the Riviera, and she was sending him messages saying, please come and visit me. I think we would love to be here on the Mediterranean so much.
Wow.
You would love the scenery here.
Wow. So it's the original Scarlett O'Hara. And it's by Nancy Smith, and they can get it on Amazon?
Yes.
Or they can contact
BarnesandNoble.com or any of those.
Okay, BarnesandNoble.com. They can also get Churchill on the Riviera.
Uh-huh.
I love that, but I'm going to have to, I've read that. I read Churchill on the Riviera, and I actually thought, Nancy, when it's a fairly big book, and I thought, oh, this is going to take me a while. I was so interested when I started reading it that I literally read it over 2 or 3 days. I could not put it down. So I have a feeling this is going to be the same way. Only Nancy Smith can give you the perspective for the viewers and the listeners of someone who's been to these parties, someone who knows how these people think. You lived around these people that have these great love affairs, these great parties, these bigger than life. They live bigger than life.
Mm-hmm.
She doesn't have to write about politics. How fresh is that? So, love and religion. relationships is what we like to talk about here, and you are the empress of love and relationships.
Oh, you're the empress of relationships.
No,
I love your relationship with Herb Weitzman. No, you all are just as close as Harry and Meghan.
Well, Herb is a prince, that's for sure. So, and of course, I have my millennial sidekick, Zach, who gives me all the fresh ideas from the millennial standpoint.
Yeah, whatever you need. I'm here for...
Ideas, for thoughts. Zach, what do you think about these great love affairs?
I'm genuinely intrigued. My dad's a history teacher, and hearing about stuff like this, the little I don't want to say back alley, but the behind the scenes stuff, you know, the things that didn't quite make the textbooks but are arguably just as important. That's really interesting.
This Franco-Prussian War. I've always heard about it but knew nothing about it. Zero, because it was France and Russia, I suppose, parts of Eastern Europe.
Well, Germany.
Was it Germany?
Well, okay. Germany became Germany at the end of the Franco-Prussian War.
See? I know so little about it. So will I learn something about it when I read these books?
I hope so.
Oh,
you know,
I
fail totally.
No, I bet I do.
I poured my heart out into these books.
Oh.
So I hope you learn a lot, Donna.
Nancy is very special. We're so lucky in Dallas to have Nancy Smith. And I know she goes all over the country and probably back to Europe. When we don't know, she's probably sneaking back over there. But Zach, are we not lucky to have someone with all this knowledge?
I think you'll know if you're at a party worth being at, if Nancy.
Absolutely.
I want to see you at a party.
Yeah, absolutely. I know. I need to. Why aren't I getting invites to these things? What's going on here?
Did your feet ever just say, "I can't do another party today"?
Mm. Oh, absolutely. I went to during the Republican convention in 1984. I went to 8 parties in one day.
Oh,
that was
wow.
my record.
Oh, wow.
I've never submitted it to the Guinness World of Book of Records, but maybe I should.
Yeah, I think you should.
84. Was that Reagan Bush? 84?
Yes. Reagan Bush.
Big year. Right. Yeah, sure. Lots of parties.
Lots of big sleeves going on clothes. Lots of big. You know, those are all coming back, the big sleeves again.
Well, good. Well, I love the formal look.
Mm-hmm.
I still have a lot in my closet. And
well,
I like the big hair, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, I know everybody wants a very sleek look these days, but I think eventually everybody will get tired of that.
Oh, definitely.
And the big hair will come back.
Yeah, we'll quit doing it in a bun or something. So it's going to come back. Mm. So, Nancy, you've been a delight. Zach, you have any other questions for Nancy? If not... we're just delighted to have you today. How lucky are we?
Yeah, thanks so much for coming.
How lucky am I? Thank you, Donna. You're such a wonderful friend. And Zach, so great to meet such a great new friend.
Yeah, it's been a pleasure.
Zach is the best sidekick ever.
Aww.
So we will see you soon. We'll be back in a couple of weeks. We have another fun guest on. If you're watching us on Facebook Live, the full Facebook Live will go up on Monday.
Memorial Day
of this. We've got a teaser out there, so you can see a little bit. Zach, how do they find our podcast?
You can find us on iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, SoundCloud, Amazon Alexa. I'm pretty sure if you say play Cinderella Cellulite, we start playing, which is crazy.
Yay.
Yes. Subscribe, rate, review. Let us know what you got going on in your life and get involved with the show.
And remember the books, Churchill on the Riviera, the original Scarlett O'Hara, and of course, Cinderella Has Cellulite is always out there, Sex and the Siren, and my new memoir,
Indeed.
The Wind Blew Innocent.
Yeah.
Next time, Nancy Smith, thank you.
Thank you, Donna.
See you next
time.
What
a pleasure. Thank you.
Bye. Zach, we're out of here.
RNCN, the digital destination for premium talk radio.